Technical difficulties?
Now we got it.
Couple things I want to share before I get started here. First of all, Jordan, I want to welcome you to Step 7. Everybody introduce yourself. You know, I hate to say this, but I need to. You know, I sometimes mention this from up front here. And Justin, you just really need to work on your attitude.
Yeah, yeah.
Today we look at step 7. We get to the end of the steps. It only took us 3 months, but we got here, okay? And this will be the last time you'll have to hear me just quickly review our 7 steps. But step 1 is we recognize that our lives have become a prison. Step 2, we considered the fact that it might be the sin in my life that causes this lack of freedom. Step 3, we considered accepting Jesus Christ as our higher power. Step 4, we bring in prayer. We prayerfully asked him to take away this desire to continue in the activity that separates us from him.
Yes.
Step 5, we kind of get into the nuts and the bolts of the ministry, what we're going to be doing from this day forward. We sought through prayer, study, and our small group, his healing gospel truth.
Amen.
And then last week, maybe the most important step of all, step 6, we accepted him.
Amen.
As our Lord and Savior. That's just a little bit important there, huh?
Mm-hmm.
And then today, step 7, we shared this message of grace. And my friends, that word is one of my favorite words, grace. I absolutely love that word. The New Testament, the Bible is just always talking about grace. And I've read this before, some of you may have heard it, but in the Greek, which the New Testament is written in, the translation for this word grace is a word called charis, C-H-A-R-I-S. And we actually get in the English language, we get the word charisma from this word charis. Grace. But I want to read, in the back of my Bible, I've got some Greek and Hebrew definitions back here, and it's a huge definition. I mean, it's huge, this definition for grace. But in the middle of it, there's this one sentence that just jumps out at me. And it says, strictly speaking, grace is the favorable disposition of God towards sinners on account of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Jesus is smiling. God is smiling on us. Not because of what we have done, but because of what has been done for us. Okay? God smiles on us. And, you know, this is step 7. We have to be about grace around here, okay? I look around the room and I see miracle after miracle after miracle. No judgment here. That's step 7. We've all got our stories. And that's the beauty of this place. You know, we can walk through that door comfortable, knowing that I can come just the way I am. And we need to focus on that here. That's step 7. We are all about God's grace. Another definition, some people call grace undeserved favor. That's a great line. Or the acronym, G-R-A-C-E, God's redemption at Christ's expense. That's a good one. Well, the Apostle Paul, he speaks constantly about grace. He starts off all the letters, all of the epistles, all of them. He starts off with grace and peace to you. My friends, the grace is the greatest news there is. Grace is the greatest gift there is, all right? And at step 7, our final step is we shared this message of grace. And as Russ said a minute ago, we are in a season right now where we're moving out. Amen. It is time for us to shout this from the rooftops.
Amen. Amen.
Okay? Let's have a prayer. Father God, we thank you. We love you. We need you. I thank you for this wonderful Sabbath day. I thank you for these friends. And hopefully, Lord, in a few minutes, I'm going to thank you for this message that you've given me. So please, Lord, just use me now. We love you and we pray this in Jesus' name. In a week from tomorrow, we celebrate Easter, Easter Sunday. And I want to take today and next week to use that context in the message. Obviously today we're talking about step 7, but it ties in really well with this season that we're in right now, this spring season where God makes everything new. I love springtime.
Amen.
The grass turns green. Yesterday was opening day for the Rockies. I'm going to start playing some more golf here pretty quick. I love the springtime. Something happens, though, every year about this time. I get this thought that keeps going through my mind, and it's beautiful, and I love it. And it makes me think of a few years back, I was in Israel. I was in Jerusalem, and I visited two of the places that they call the tomb. Okay, now there's a few places in Jerusalem. They're not really sure about which is which. Actually, there's probably 4 or 5 that some people will say, no, this is the tomb, no, this is the tomb. I went to the 2 main ones, and it was wonderful. The first one is called the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. Okay, now a sepulchre is simply a tomb, almost like a cave. Stack of rocks, but it's a tomb, a sepulcher. And it's this church, it's this old church, it's in the old city of Jerusalem. It just gave me goosebumps to go visit that place. And then there's another one that I like even more, to tell you the truth, and it's simply called the Garden Tomb. And it's a beautiful place, a wonderful garden. There's this kind of this cliff wall, and there's a tomb. That's probably the one that a lot of you have just seen that picture of a hole in the rock. Okay, and you can go in there, and there's 2 little rooms in there, and you can even sit down. And boy, talk about goosebumps. It was awesome. But as I mentioned, this time of year, I start to think about the tomb. And then a few years back, I had the pleasure of being able to visit. And there's something I get really excited about when it comes to those tombs. There's something that jumps off the page at me. What do you think that might be?
The fact that it's empty.
Pardon me?
The fact that it's empty.
Boom. You nailed it. I'm excited because both of those tombs that I visited are empty.
Amen.
Amen.
And they have been empty for 2,000 years, since Easter Sunday, 2,000 years ago. Those tombs have been empty. And my friends, today we shared this message of grace. There is no good news without the resurrection, period. There is no grace without the resurrection. Turn, please, to 2 Timothy. There's a bunch of T's towards the back there. Thessalonians, Titus, Timothy. There's a whole bunch of them back there. Second Timothy chapter 4. And I'm going to read verses 1 through 5. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1. It says, in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who will judge the living and the dead, and in view of his appearing and his kingdom, I give you this charge. Preach the word. Be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. For the time will come when men will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myths. But you keep your head in all situations. Endure hardship. Do the work of an evangelist. Discharge all the duties of your ministry. Now, I need to be kind of careful here. This is what's known as one of the pastoral letters. We have 1 and 2 Timothy, we have Titus, and they're known as pastoral letters. And I'm not trying to heap this on your shoulders today. This is a big meatball right here, okay? And, you know, it says in verse 2, preach the word, be prepared in season and out of season, correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. Well, most of you would say, well, PT, that's your job. And you know what? You're right. That's my job. Okay. This is a pastoral letter. This is the place where, and I've told some of you this before, this is where I got called into ministry. Right here. And it was years ago. I was sitting by my pool down in Arizona. I had just finished playing 18 holes of golf. Cindy and I were out at the pool, and I was reading my Bible like I do every day, did every day. And I read this, and it's like Jesus said to me, Tom, I want you to go into ministry. And it was like, you know, no thank you. I'm not going to do that. Well, long story short, here I stand. And you know, my buddy Dave Kennedy, Pastor Dave, he told me this is where he got called. I would imagine there are a ton of pastors out there that'll tell you, 2 Timothy chapter 4, that's what did me in. But I want you to notice something that's very important about these verses. Go to the end. Go to verse 5. It says, but you keep your head in all situations. Endure hardship. Do the work of an evangelist. Discharge all the duties of your ministry. My friends, we have all been called to go. All of us. We have a wonderful relationship with Jesus Christ. He's our Lord and Savior. And there's a responsibility in knowing that. He wants us to go and share him. My friends, you were bought at a price. And it was a very expensive price. And he simply asks us now to go and share this message of grace. Turn, please. I'm going to make you turn a couple times here. Turn to your left, just a very little ways, to Ephesians chapter 4. I love this chapter. Ephesians chapter 4, and we're going to see here Paul writing to the church in Ephesus. He goes over a few of the spiritual gifts here, and we'll look at that. Verse 11. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. And Paul says, it was he who gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, and some to be pastors and teachers, to prepare God's people for works of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. So right out of the gate here, we see he mentions five of these spiritual gifts: apostles, preaching, pastoring, teaching. But he also mentions that word evangelist in there. Evangelist. He goes on to say that we're all to be trained in works of service. And that those works of service are for what? To build up the church. And that we can all become mature. He finishes it out. And become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. My friends, I hope and pray. I want for me and I want for you to be known as a mature Christian. It's very important. A person of your word. It's very important to be a person of our word. A mature Christian who now has kind of this thinking that I'm an evangelist. I am an evangelist, and we're called to this. You guys, turn to your right. 1 Peter, pretty far towards your back. 1 Peter, chapter 2. And look at verse 4. 1 Peter, chapter 2, verse 4. It says, as you come to him, the living stone, rejected by men, but chosen by God and precious to him, you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood. Wow. Offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For in Scripture it says, see, I lay a stone in Zion, a chosen and precious cornerstone. And the one who trusts in him will never be put to shame. So we see him talking about this stone, this cornerstone. Obviously, Jesus Christ, right? But notice what he says up above that. We are being built into a holy priesthood, folks. You and I. There's a responsibility here. Jump to verse 9, and he reinforces it. Verse 9 in the same chapter. Peter says, but you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. And you guys here at step 7, you have received mercy.
Amen.
Through this relationship with Jesus Christ that we focus on. Okay? He says that you were called out of darkness, that you may declare the praises of him. Well, my friends, that is step 7. We simply share this message of grace. I talk about this word evangelist. In the Greek, the word, the Greek translation for evangelist, and I'm going to rate the pronunciation. euangelistus. Euangelistus is what an evangelist is in the New Testament. And the root word for euangelistus is simply the first two letters. The root word is you, spelled E-U. It's a Greek word. And it simply means good news. E-U, good news, or what we might say, the gospel. And my friends, we have the gospel here. That snaps up. For me, it's a very simple little statement. I'm a sinner in need of a Savior. I've got one. His name is Jesus Christ. And he saved me 2,000 years ago at the cross. And the day's coming when he's coming, hopefully real soon, to take me home. That's the gospel, my friends. And so if we have this word you, which simply means good news, and then we have this other word, euangelistes, that's the evangelist. An evangelist is what? Simply someone who brings good news. And we can all do that. We can all do that, right? Last time, I'll make you turn anywhere. Turn to Romans. To your left, not too far. An evangelist is someone who brings good news. Romans chapter 10. And I'm going to read 14 and 15. And it says, how then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one of whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? And how can they preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. That's what we're all about around here. How beautiful are those who bring good news. And again, friends, I have to say, without the resurrection, there is no good news. There is no grace without the resurrection. And it's a very simple process here. You don't have to be able to quote chapter and verse. You just need to give your testimony. This is where I was. This is who I met. This is where I'm at. It's made all the difference in the world in my life. That's evangelism, my friends. It's no different than going to a movie that you enjoy and sharing it with someone. Going to a restaurant and saying, man, you gotta try this place out. It's that simple, but it's so much better. My friends, we have the gift of peace here. We have the gift of freedom here at Step 7, okay? We have the secret of life eternal right here and right here at Step 7, okay? People should be kicking the door down to get in here. They should be hanging from the rafters. And that's the season we're entering in here. We share this message of grace. And finally, folks, the greatest story ever told, the greatest news that we could get, the greatest gift that we can receive is the simple knowledge that the tomb is empty.
Amen.
Father God, Lord, we thank you. We thank you for this season. We thank you for this ministry. And Lord, we do especially thank you for the fact that the tomb is empty. And a day is coming when you're coming to take us home, and I just pray that you would hasten that day. Lord, we are ready. Please, come soon. But in the meantime, help us to be faithful, help us to be obedient in sharing this message of grace, Lord. Again, I thank you, we love you, and we pray this as we always do. In that precious, precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thanks for coming, everybody.
Thank you.
Justin.